Welcome to Pleasantville, guys.
Nice to be in Pleasantville. Is it very pleasant here? It seems it.
As Paul Reiser once said, he said, thank God they didn't call it Bastard Town. So, Louie, this is the fourth night in a row we've been together. Yeah. We've got to stop meeting like this. Three nights ago, we were in San Francisco. It was like a rock concert, and it was really crazy at the Castro Theater, 1,400 people with hundreds of people that showed up just hoping to get in. It opened in Denver 4 weeks ago, and we hoped that we'd have a good opening weekend, and it would run through the rest of the week and then go to the next place. And it's now in its fifth week in Denver. Portland, Boulder, Santa Cruz. I mean, it's really something. And it strikes me that this is a film that took over a decade to make. And we've talked a little bit about this. It's like, you know, mycelium under the ground, just waiting for the right moment and the right conditions to emerge. And I'm wondering, you know, as you're navigating this film, if you can talk a little bit about what you think those conditions are, but also, what do you take from that experience? I mean, you know, you've been that mycelium underground for a while and just emerging and just fruiting. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, I think that the big takeaway for me in making this film was this idea of interconnection. And I really want to thank Stephen because we just met
six months ago,
at TED. And he kind of quickly said, hey, I think I might be able to help you, because I was at a crossroads of trying to figure out, do I sell my film to a platform like Netflix or Amazon, where they would own it, control it, they wouldn't do a theatrical, or do we try to independently get support to do it on our own? And Stephen had done this before, and he felt that the timing was right. So the connection that I made to Stephen, the connection that I've made to some of the people in this audience who have generously supported our effort to do this as an independently distributed film, which, if you know, well, you guys are probably aware that this is extraordinarily difficult to do, if not impossible. We have no ad budget, no marketing budget, really. We're just going out there and relying on all of you to show up, to buzz it up on social media, to talk to each other. So you are the evidence that there is a mycelial network that's happening underground that's bringing all of you Jedi Knight warriors together into this room to be a part of a cultural underground movement that is happening right now. And as to why it's happening right now, I don't exactly know, other than the fact that things maybe go in cycles and the timing is right. I mean, we certainly are at an environmental crisis. We're at a crisis of, you know, people with depression, the amount of people that are dying with opioids. I mean, we are at a critical time in our history, and the idea that a social network under the ground where ecosystems flourish so that all of us can, you know, live in harmony, not based on greed, is a beautiful model to look at without being preachy, but that's nature's operating instructions. And you have to kind of ask yourself, why can't we sort of mirror that kind of behavior? And so this is a perfect time in history, I think, to absorb nature's intelligence, to be able to be moved by nature's beauty, and to be able to come together as communities to be the change we want to be.
I think somebody also in the mycelial world and sort of working tirelessly to allow all of this to reemerge is Tony Bossis. And Tony, you've seen through a scale of time as well all of this work and it now beginning to reemerge. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Thank you, Louie. Absolutely incredible. Thank you, Stephen. So I'm very lucky. We're very grateful for the work we're doing. And it's the clinical application of these medicines, of psilocybin, which is a remarkable compound. I'm going to say two quick things. One, what we're finding clinically from it, and something more remarkable. The clinical part is that we see it's addressing things like depression, anxiety, addiction, and more importantly for me, how we die. So I spent years in palliative care working with people at the end of life, and we don't die well. It's a problem in our culture. It really is the final taboo. We're getting better at it, but we're not great. And there's a paucity of tools in our tool bag to treat the end-of-life anxiety, the existential and spiritual distress that we could have as we leave this incredible thing we have called life. And one session with this medicine has promoted incredible resolution of depression, end-of-life anxiety. And Johns Hopkins and us at NYU published papers that some of you may have seen in 2016, showing that one psilocybin-generated mystical experience, and I'll define that in a second, resulted in a dramatic drop-off of depression, anxiety, demoralization, hopelessness, helplessness, and increased existential well-being and spiritual well-being, and erased, for the most part, the fear of the end of life. And that's remarkable. What I find more remarkable than even that, which is remarkable enough, is that it seems the predictor of the positive outcomes, the mediating effect, is a thing called the mystical experience, or peak experience, or Carl Jung called the numinosity. About 70% of the time, people took psilocybin during this trip, to use street language, experienced this mystical experience that Roland talked about in the film, transcendence, this incredible sense of transcending our body, the time and space, this existence. And if you're dying and your body's beginning to fail and won't work soon, the insight that I'm more than this body, that I'm not my cancer, there's something more enduring within me, or even outside biology, is incredible. A profound sense of unity, that all things are connected, literally connected, that you and I are not separate. It's an illusion, we're all separate. A William James term called the noetic quality, people encountering what they say is ultimate reality. No one in this study says, oh, it was a drug effect. They all say, that was reality. Yeah. That was ultimate reality. And things like that. One is ineffability as well. The remarkable thing about all this is that that experience is at the foundation of the world's major religions, of the world's major traditions. Been around for thousands of years, these experiences. They occur naturally, and they occur with the medicines. So the naturally occurring experiences found at the mystic core of religion, as the great Aldous Huxley called the perennial philosophy. And throughout indigenous culture, including ancient Greece where they used these medicines, and Plato took part in those. And now the medicines can reliably generate that experience that we're wired for. So what's striking is that what we seem to be wired for meaning, naturally wired for these incredible experiences that may provide insight into what is consciousness, where is consciousness, what is all this, that seems to be at the core of our traditions. So what a tool these medicines are for understanding consciousness and treating illnesses that we can't treat, like alcoholism, like depression, and like end-of-life distress. So it's been a real treat. And
since you went there and you started talking about mystical traditions, what I want to talk about is this nexus of science and spirituality. Because it's something I think that that is captured in your work, Tony, is captured in your work, Louie, and certainly captured in Paul Stamets' work as well. And it's understandable how these clinical studies of bringing these medicines back are being done through addiction, through end-of-life anxiety and all of that. But they're not only being done there, because it's also about people who are well. You know, it is about a shift of consciousness, and the connection there is around the religious traditions, because I know that you've been involved in a study that's just finishing with clergy and psilocybin. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, so that's exciting. We're not done yet, so we can't speak too much about the results, because not all in yet, but it will be very compelling, I promise you.
Do it.
Say again?
Do it.
but like the film addressed, since these experiences seem to be at the heart of whatever is consciousness, and by the way, no one knows what consciousness is and where or how it's generated. In the physics, they call it the heart problem. What's generated in this thing we have called mind? And there's no proof that the brain generates that. There's a growing opinion that maybe outside the brain. It's non-local. It's outside biology, in a sense, and we kind of just bring it in. And by the way, science and religion were not always separate, right? We see them as separate entities these days, but until the 16th century or so, they were part of the same path of unfolding. I mean, I see science and religion as both just human impulses to describe what is this? Where are we?
Albert Einstein would probably agree with you.
Einstein would agree with that comment, and he said famously, thanks for the, that's perfect. He said famously, science without religion is lame, religion without science is blind. So the study we're looking at is to bring in religious leaders of all traditions, kind of piggybacking a very famous study done in 1962 with Walter Pahnke, who was a minister and a great psychiatrist and one of the pioneers in psilocybin research and LSD research. And letting them have the experience. And let's try to map out the landscape of mystical experience. You know, I think one way of measuring reality or science that they measure it is with observable findings. There's another way called phenomenology or just our subjective experiences. So to gather all these different experiences about this mystical experience to help us understand that. And that these mushrooms, this fungi, grows on the planet, humans eat it, and have this incredible insight into who and what we are, and now treat profound, you know, clinical applications is just really stunning. So the applications seem endless. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Louie? Yeah.
Well, you know, I think I just want to add, too, that, you know, I think the intersection between art, science, and technology is wonder and awe. And that's like the moment of bliss that, you know, any mystical experience will take you to, is to be in the moment, you know, no past, no future, filled with wonder and awe. I think we've all experienced it, you know, whether you're staring at a flower or surfing a wave, you know, some, you know, ecstatic moment. And, you know, science, you know, wants to unveil the mystery with the scientific method by creating, you know, a certain pathway of repeatable data. Artists have the ability to tell stories, sing songs, write poems, be romantic about this thing called life and love. And but we're both trying to really constantly trying to explain, what is this all about? It is a valid question you ought to ask yourself every morning when you wake up. Who am I? What am I doing? How did this all happen? I mean, to be to have that kind of terra incognita of a blank slate and not have preconceived ideas is a very healthy thing to do. And to quote our buddy Einstein again, they asked him his definition of God, and his definition is it's a sense of wonder. So.
And Einstein called the mystical experience the most important experience that we have. You mentioned love, and when I first began talking about love, I'm probably going to do this as a scientist, talking about love wherever I go. So, in following the data, which scientists try to do, the most powerful experience people have that, say, recalibrated how they die, is this experience of love. And not just loving kindness towards self, which is profound if you're dying, and forgiveness, also for other people, including people throughout their lifespan who may not have been great to them. People who've abused them, they forgive and they love. And then what I find remarkable, and I use the Greek term because I'm a Greek, agape, which is like divine love. And the people in our studies, in the cancer studies, and on the other studies at Hopkins and NYU, describe the essence of whatever this is as a fabric that they call love. Now, love is just a word we created, but they describe it in that kind of essence, which is just always stunning to hear. And again, you see that same language in the foundations of all the religions, from the Abrahamic religions to the Eastern religions. We see this common core, again, that is remarkable. That might be the foundations of those other religions, and they're not separate silos. There's one ultimate reality, and they all seem to address that in this incredible language. And it's a shame that religion has taken a big hit. And for many reasons, appropriately so, of what it's done over the years. But at the core, they're trying to describe this experience that these people are trying to describe with the medicine.
I'm glad you got to the word love, because I think it is at the core of these experiences and what's emerging. And it makes me think of Mary Cosimano, who's one of the Johns Hopkins people in the film, who has now done, I think, over 450 sessions. Psilocybin sessions with people, not that she's done herself, that she's facilitated. And you can't have a conversation without it being grounded right there. And one of the things we've always wanted to do is to have Tony and Mary in conversation together, which we will do. But it does seem to be at the core of the experience and at the core of what we need today. I want to open it up for questions from the audience, and there's going to be a mic that's going around. And as you're thinking about that, Louie, there were two questions. I mean, we had lines of questions at San Francisco. We could have been there for 4 hours. But there were two questions that stood out for me, and one was from a religious perspective. If you remember, it was an older woman who is a conservative Christian woman, and she had had a psilocybin experience, and she said it's what brought her back into the church in the most amazing way, actually understanding what her religion was about, and wanting to know how do we bring this more into that realm. The other was from a little 10-year-old girl. And she spoke from that place of wonder and awe. And she waited very patiently in line, and when she got the microphone, I think she had like 6 or 7 questions. And everybody was incredibly patient. I mean, it was like you were in her presence, and she was very commanding. But her first question was, where can I go to school and study this?
Yeah, that was great. I think that we're all turned on by nature's beauty. I think beauty is nature's tool for survival. We protect what we love. We're hardwired to do that. And I think that's what appealed to the 10-year-old child. And I think it's what also worked with the woman who, you know, was a conservative Christian and was, you know, I think she was actually taking SSRIs because she had depression. She had and the psilocybin experience helped her, you know, break that cycle. So as you can tell from the film, I mean, a lot of people say it's beautiful. You know, I take that as, you know, not as a superficial compliment, but the fact that it connected with the deepest part of your soul. I mean, nobody taught anybody in this audience what is beauty. You see it, you know it when you see it, right? You connect. And some people say they get emotional, they cry. It's not a sad movie, but it's a homecoming to your inner self. So I'm just trying to channel that. And I think that, you know, it's the same thing, the mystical experience. You know, it doesn't have to be with psilocybin or any kind of, you know, sacred medicine. You know, for me, nature's beauty is one way to do a deep dive into the mystical experience. Being able to break your perception of time and scale, you know, with the time lapse, the slow motion. It's not just a cinematographic technique. It's a way to kind of, you know, break the mold in the mind to be able to see things from the point of view of a flower or a hummingbird, to be able to, you know, broaden your horizons. And I think that what's beautiful about maybe the end result of this movie is that I'm not telling anybody what to do. We're not preaching anyone to say, you know, you should do psilocybin or any of that. I think it's just, you know, look at what people are doing. Look at what nature does. Look at the mycelium network. You know, what a beautiful, organized operating system that works, that doesn't waste a single molecule, that is efficient, that it's environmentally conscious. And that's the wake-up call I think we need right now, is to follow these types of systems where we can love each other, where we don't have to damage the earth, and to be able to live in harmony with each other.
Beautiful.
Take that just one step further, and I'm going to editorialize a little bit. It's interesting these medicines come back now, this era. And breaking news, things aren't going so well out there. and it seems we're at an inflection point, possibly, or some kind of paradigm shift, right? On so many levels, the planet, our political systems, what we're doing to each other. And so what Louis is saying, could that, you know, these messages be cultivated at this important time in our evolution? A recent Pew study, by the way, showed 49% of people have naturally occurring mystical experiences. So this is one way, but we're hardwired for meaning. It's our birthright. It's interesting that back now, during this incredible time with the planet also having such
problems. Yeah. There's two major initiatives that we have with the film, aside from creating these conversations all around the country and the world. In fact, the film is going to play at COP25 in Santiago, Chile, with the United Nations around climate change. But we have two major initiatives, and one is, I'm thinking about the 10-year-old girl, we're in the process of cutting an educational version that would be shorter. It would still have some of the therapeutic pieces like Johns Hopkins and all that. It wouldn't have Paul talking about climbing a tree and taking massive doses of of mushrooms. But it'll be used in middle schools and high schools with a curriculum, with grow kits, so the kids can have the can actually experience the wonder of this of these mushrooms fruiting in front of them. And we are extraordinarily grateful that we have a generous donation to make all of that possible. The second initiative, which we're just undertaking, is to create a medical therapeutic version that's even heavier on those elements to be used almost as like a facilitation guide for the medical community, because therapists, social workers, psychiatrists, doctors are all, first of all, they're dealing with all the suffering that's out there and they don't have the answers. Then the second thing is they're being increasingly asked by their patients about these things. So one of the exciting things about that is that the film is actually going to be screened as part of a major palliative care conference at Harvard in January. The next day at Tufts, Tony is going to be doing grand rounds for their doctors at Tufts Medical Center. Cornell in New York City has asked to do this, and we're getting requests from all over the country to bring this into those settings, which is also a really exciting aspect of this.
Incredible.
Questions from the audience.
So thank you for doing this. I have a question. Have there been any long-term studies of people who took psilocybin in the 60s experimenting when we were young and see what if any long-term effects there have been relative to some of the things you're finding now?
So great question. So of course, so it's important to know that the two important arms to come out of the 1950s, 60s research, by the way, it was legal then. These were peer-reviewed, government-approved studies, and it was very commonplace. Cary Grant spoke openly about how it changed his life. There were articles in Good Housekeeping. So it's kind of a, in black and white, Father Knows Best America, this was kind of happening. There were two major chains of research: addiction, alcoholism, and end of life. Clearly, the end of life people are no longer around to report on their experience. But there was a study in 1962 with, healthy theology students who took psilocybin. One of them was Houston Smith, the great religious scholar. And they were tracked down about 2.5 decades later, and they still reported the experience as the top most spiritual and meaningful experience of their lifetime, decades later, the one experience. So it does seem to have these sustaining effects, and we're tracking our patients. And again, that we see these sustained effects over time, because it isn't a drug per se. But you know, you take your whatever you all are on today, your Prozacs and your cardiovascular drugs, they work while they're in the body. This is one experience, but the memory is transformative potentially, and that memory lingers a lifetime. Just as when you had your first baby or something incredible happened, the memory is transformative. So it does seem to be sustaining, and we're going to keep looking into that.
What's interesting is, you know, you think about from that moment to where we are today and the break. Right? And the break, which the film talks about, is the war on drugs and losing control of our populace, right? But one thing that also happened is the pharmaceutical companies. And you can make money off of an annuity. You know, if you have somebody who's dealing with an opiate addiction and you put them on methadone, you know, that's a $6,000 a year habit for the rest of your life. You know, you got to show up to the drugstore every day to get your methadone, you know, as opposed to a singular experience. So if you can't make money on it, if you can't patent it, if you can't have intellectual property, that's a problem. In our society, that's a problem. How many people have read the Michael Pollan book, How to Change Your Mind?
Wow. Can I ask how many people have not done a psychedelic experience, have not done it?
Turn the cameras off.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Michael Pollan, who's a important part of the film, is actually going to be doing a conversation with us in Boston on December 4th, I think. He's also been involved. Next question.
This is related to the last question, but most of the experiences that you've shared with us all sound exquisitely amazing, and I'm wondering, do you warn people that there may not, they may not have that kind, and have you had terrible reports of some people who have had really upsetting experiences?
Really important question. So, yes. So it isn't all peaches and cream. Everything is wonderful. When you, you know, an encounter with the self can be profoundly challenging, right? And so first of all, we learned two things, going back 75 years with the research. Two things matter, how the drug is taken, set and setting. Set the person's mindset, who they are, their intentions for taking the medicine, how they're prepared, and then setting, where and how it's done. So in spiritual, sacred, controlled, safe settings, the results have been incredible. Take it on the street at a concert, unprepared, unscreened, and all bets are off how the experience may go. People in the studies, we've had no serious adverse effects in all the cases we've had, hundreds now in the country. However, there are challenging parts of the journey. In one study, our study, people were facing death. So it could be difficult, it could be dark, but at the end, there's this kind of walking through that dark night of the soul to a place of, I'm okay, this will be okay, and to insights, maybe there's more to life than this body. There's a great word in Greek again called galimorpi, which says like sweet sorrow or bitter mourning or bittersweet mourning. People often weep during the sessions. And when we asked them later why they were weeping, because of the beauty and transcendence, but also of the horror that we do to each other, to the planet, to the sorrow, to be human is both incredible and sorrowful. And so you get this mix of melancholy and this incredible positive sense of this is going to be okay. But yes, it can be challenging, and I certainly don't recommend it to go and take it on your own on the street. We're talking about controlled settings where the people are guided before then and after to integrate the experience. So it's a great question.
Part of the issue is our relationship to sadness and struggle, right? Because a lot of the pharmaceuticals that we're given are given to suppress that, but also to suppress the fullest experience. So it's the shift of that relationship. And I think that when you talk about set and setting, one thing that's interesting in the way that it's reemerged is in the medical model is with trained psychedelic therapists. So it's not something you're just given and sent off to go have an experience, but there are people who have, there are now three cohorts of people that have come out of CIIS, for instance, that are trained psychedelic therapists. And that's really an important element of, as well as the way that, that experience is then integrated into your understanding of how you move forward in life.
And that's a great point. So antidepressants and psychiatry until now tries to kind of clip off the depressive part of our experience, cut out the bottom, darker piece. This is the opposite. This is actually, once someone takes the medicine, there's kind of this journey unfolds where they move into that darkness, into the sorrow, into the reality of who we are. And we encourage that. So one of the main guidelines of preparing them for the experience is to go into the unfolding, whatever it is, like you would in a meditation practice. So whatever's unfolding, stay with it and move into it. Don't run from it, as Bill Richards said in the film. And I've never seen a case in 10 years doing this, over 10 years, where someone moved into it and it didn't become an insightful, transformative piece. If they ran from it, tried to avoid it, it became, what street language, a bad trip. But there are lessons even in the hard parts of who we are. And so, yeah, it's the opposite of taking your Prozac every day to clip a negative part of who we are. But who are we? What's the full encounter of what this is? And what is death? And people have said incredible things like, I'm okay with death. The death of the body may not be the end of consciousness, or it is the end, but I'm okay right now. This is an incredible miracle, and I'm fine with it. And the fear of death is erased.
It's also interesting that one of the prerequisites to participate in these studies is to be off of those SSRIs,
yeah,
so that you're not numbed, but that the receptors are actually right, available. Next question.
Hi. I wanted to bring the conversation back to the other aspect of fungi that the film talked about from the beginning, which was its capacity to heal our environment from the incredible mess that we put it in. I just wanted to say I've been in love with mushroom mycelium for decades, as you can see from my sweater. And, you know, because of this phenomenal connectivity that it has through underground, through things that we don't see. And my religion is my compost pile because of the capacity to resurrect dead material into life. So I had been really interested in Paul Stamets' research showing that mushrooms can digest oil spills, and I've heard something more recently about mushrooms being able to digest plastics. Maybe you know that our oceans are projected by scientists to contain more plastics by weight in the year 2050 than fish. So if we don't change the way that we're dealing with plastic, we are not going to have a livable planet.
Right.
So I just wanted to know whether any of you guys have information about whether research is being done on mushrooms or fungus of some kind being able to digest plastics underwater deep in the oceans where these plastics are now infiltrating.
Well, we were on some panels recently with Paul, and this question does come up a lot. In terms of the bioremediation for things like oil spills and toxic waste, you know, there's Paul just can't, as a single person, go against this giant, you know, industry where, you know, when there's an oil spill, then these giant chemical companies come in with more toxic poisons and say, oh, we can clean it up. And so it's a battle that he's done, and now he says, well, I'd rather work on saving the bees than trying to figure out this other stuff, because it's just monumental. I'm aware of the research with fungi being able to, you know, break down plastics, and I think there's some positive results that are happening in that area, but it's still in the research stage. I'm not aware of anything that's gone public yet.
You can check out also radical mycology, which is mentioned here, but there are a variety of projects that are going on with different applications using mycelium. And the other thing I'd mention is, before I forget, is because you mentioned Paul Stamets, who's an extraordinary person, as you see in the film. He and Louie worked on a book together called Fantastic Fungi, sort of a companion to this. It has amazing photographs and also has essays from all of the people who participated in the film. And we actually have a few of those books available for sale after the screening down here, and Louie has agreed to sign them. So I just wanted to mention that as well. Next question.
Is your NYU study a placebo-controlled study?
It was. The cancer study was, and most have been placebo-controlled. And quickly, so what are the implications for the future? We're hoping in 5, 7, 8 years that the FDA and the DEA would reschedule psilocybin, now a Schedule I drug and not legal, for various clinical applications. And what I'm most interested in, of course, is could we build centers, which was Albert Hofmann's dream, who discovered LSD back in the 30s, where people can go, in this case, end-of-life patients, have an experience, maybe two of them, embedded within a few weeks of psychotherapy and other modalities, and then return to their home. And that was the old ancient Greece model of Eleusinian mysteries. You went to this place, had the experience, and went back to your life. But yes, they were all placebo, double-blind, random-controlled.
Although having now been with a few people who participated in the studies, who were patients in the studies, one of the things that's interesting about this is that it's a very hard thing to do, Tony, to do with the placebo, because they have to sit there for 8 hours and they know it hasn't taken effect, and they're like, really? Can I get the other one?
Yeah, I heard they did it with some Tibetan monks. That half of them got, you know, placebo, half of them got the psilocybin. You know, the half that got the psilocybin said it was the most profound meditative experience they ever had. The other half of the monks that didn't get it were just pissed off.
and in the cancer study, so people said there's their own control, so they had medicine A the first time, 7 weeks later the other one. If it was placebo first, that was a real drag. If it was placebo second, it was not a bad session, because they had the same music, which is a gorgeous six-hour track of music, same eye shades, and then going back within, but with the memories of the seven-week prior experience to kind of almost give them a bit of a lift. So that was always better than placebo first, which was after 3 hours, nothing's happening,
see,
doc.
See, that's such an interesting thing, because I think that's one of the profound things about these medicines and these experiences, is that it creates a touchstone that you can return to. So that's why, first of all, they're non-addictive, right? I mean, right? So that's a huge thing. And second, it creates an experience that's a touchstone that you can return to, which is why you don't need to continually take these things on a daily basis to...
Yeah, that's crucial. I mean, so it's a paradigm shift. Every medicine everyone take every day. This is one shot. The great, who knows Alan Watts? What a hip, Pleasantville. So Alan Watts once said regarding psychedelics, when you get the message, you hang up the phone. You don't got to keep taking it. And that's the beauty of these medicines or these sacraments. You take them once, in the case of the end of life or addiction, and people are transformed, which is a remarkable way of looking at medicine versus every day to get the desired effect.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Well, I want to congratulate all of you and all the people that had something to do with making this film. And I kind of view it as a seed for a grassroots paradigm shift movement. Number one, you make profound analogies of mycelia with the network of brain tissue, which looks just like the cosmos. Number two, you have a number of agents here that are not patentable, so pharmaceutical companies can't make money on them, which is really the only reason they're in business. They don't want a cure for cancer, because if they had one, they'd lose money. And I know from studying this, because I'm a physician for 35 years, an academic physician, that there are mushrooms which are useful in killing cancer and killing eye disease. I'm a neuro-ophthalmologist. They block the formation of substances in the eye that cause bleeding, et cetera, et cetera. You've tapped into something here. This film should be in every elementary school, junior high school, and college campus to be seen by everyone.
And you're on the team.
It would start a movement. And I'm not trying to badmouth the medical profession, because I was a wonderful part of it and still am for a long time. But we need to do something here. The system isn't working. And you have something that you said in the film. The surface has barely been scratched.
Wow. You know, I
thank you so much. That's exactly, thank you.
I mean, I can share that, my brother's he's the CEO of Tufts Medical in Boston, and was not sort of open to a lot of this stuff until the Michael Pollan book came out, and I sent it to him. And then I said, just take a look at the film. And he watched the film, and he agreed to come to a Boston psychedelic research group meeting with doctors and clinicians from the Boston area. And he walked in, and the first person he saw was his chief of psychiatry, who is the former president of the American Psychiatric Association. And he said, there is so much suffering that we're dealing with in this country right now, and we don't have the solutions. And these may be the solutions. So there is interest now from the medical community to begin to be open to this conversation, at least.
Yeah. And I just want to add, not from strictly the medical point of view, but he asked earlier, like, the first question was like, why is this happening now? And when I was filming Bob Jesse, when he was talking about the fact that, you know, you couldn't talk about that experience for fear of prosecution or losing your job, I for the first time kind of realized that this is equivalent to religious persecution. Somebody has a spiritual experience, and this is like, I shot that 5 years ago when it wasn't as easy to talk about any of this in the open. And I could tell it was maybe the first time he was saying it on camera to a guy he really doesn't know, but it felt great for him to say it, and he was getting choked up, and then I got choked up because I'm Jewish, My parents are Holocaust survivors. I know what it's like to have this legacy of persecution for a belief system, you know? And if a spiritual faith is being crushed and held back, it's going to like explode when the time is right. And now I think the time is happening. You know, you can't force people to hold back on their religious or spiritual, you know, values. And the time is happening now. I think that's part of it.
And in speaking of religious persecution, you even have the book burning sequence.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
We have time for one more question.
Great. Pressure's on.
Yeah.
Congratulations on a fabulous film. This was really inspiring. Can you talk a little bit about those young people who were inspired to study mycology? And tell us a little bit more about that, and how can that be used to inspire teachers and professors to help them get the next generation involved?
It was just the tip of the iceberg of what I tried to include in the movie. I mean, there's so much. This really needs to be like a 10-part miniseries. It's like the cliff notes of mushrooms. And but like William Padilla in, you know, in the inner city. I mean, the fact that you can grow mushrooms anywhere, you know. Trad Cotter is growing mushrooms in Jamaica to help them rebuild after, you know, the hurricanes they've had. And also maybe build up the tourism too. But all kinds of mushrooms, edible mushrooms, psychedelic mushrooms. At the Telluride, you know, mushroom festival, so many young people are fascinated with mushrooms and want to learn about mushrooms. And as Stephen has mentioned, you know, we're going to create an educational curriculum. I mean, a lot of people think mushrooms are a plant. You know, it's a separate kingdom. Recently, I was at Penn State about 3 weeks ago. You know, 50,000 students, and guess what? They are creating a sustainability, you know, not even a department. A sustainability,
research.
Yeah, well, a study program that isn't in a building, but encompasses everything: engineering, biology, you know, environmental, you know, building, everything. Sustainability is what young people are asking for. They don't have a department, so it's an interdepartmental study called sustainability. That's what mushrooms do. They create an immune, sustainable planet for us. And the young people are into it.
Speaking of the next generation, we get countless emails. I mean, I can't answer them all. From medical students, how do I get into this? From college students, how do I get into this? And from high school students that are the cutest letters on the planet, you know, saying, I heard about this research, I saw a commercial, a book, or I read part of Michael Pollan. Can I do a school report on it? Can you help me? Kids. And then tons of medical school from psychiatry, neurology. So the next generation is there because we're getting older. We all got the white thing going, and so it's really that's important.
It's also a great question because we're just in the middle of doing planning around this educational initiative, and you touched on something that's really important to the work that we're doing because one of the things that Marcina's envisioned has in fact. As we build the curriculum, is to bring the Paul Stamets and the senior mycologists of the world together with the younger people, to have that knowledge transferred, to have those inspirational connections, you know, to build that mycelial network, and then to have the curriculum come through there, so that we have ambassadors from the mycelial kingdom, not just this film, but human ambassadors from the mycelial kingdom that can go into each of these classrooms and support that work. So, great question. I think that we could go on forever. One thing that's really important to understand is that this film, it's very, very difficult to release a film today in the United States that's not a big studio film, that's not the fifth sequel to the, you know, superhero. You know, the superhero actually is on the screen today. You saw that, right? But it doesn't say Captain Marvel or whatever else, although it does have Brie Larson.
Well, we did have Brie Larson as the badass, you know, female.
Exactly. So this film is being released with zero marketing budget. And the way that it's working is through the mycelial network. And you guys are now part of that network. The only way this film gets out there is for it to be spread through social media, for you to bring people. One of the things that's really beautiful about this film, for me, is that it allows us to have these conversations. You know, I showed this film to my parents who were in their mid-80s, and my mom just sent me a picture of her lion's mane bottle. She's now taking lion's mane. But they also were really interested in all of the aspects of this. So the conversations that can be created with your parents, with your friends, with your coworkers, with your children, are really profound. And so we're really grateful that not only do we have another screening tonight, but this film is opening here, with every place else around the country, it's opening here, which is an important place to me, obviously, this Friday, October 18th. And I know Brian said if you check the website tomorrow, I think, or Tuesday, it'll all be up. A Wednesday, it'll all be up and you'll be able to buy tickets. And so bring your friends, bring your family members, and we'll continue to build this network and have these conversations because you're really an instrumental part of it. I want to, it is, as I said, it's always fun to be back here. It's always fun to be back here with really amazing guests. Mm-hmm. And I'm so grateful for the work that you do in the world, Tony Bossis, and it's really, it's been an honor to get to know you and to see what you're doing and to do this work with you. And Louie, somehow we found each other in this world with Marcina, with Sarah, with so many other people. And it's been an amazing journey and continues. And I, for one, hope that we will have you back here with your other films as well in the future. And I'm so grateful for you being here.
Yeah, I got to just thank you again, Stephen, because if you hadn't reached out to me and said, I think I can help you, I go, you know, he gives me his business card, and usually that doesn't turn into anything. But it did. And I was at that crossroads. You know, I didn't know what to do. You know, it was a lowball offer. You know, people would watch it on their digital device. More separation, more disconnection from each other, from nature. He said he had done it. You know, he's not like a famous Hollywood guy. But he had this, you know, incredible story about how many hundreds, 400, you know, community screenings you guys do here, how he's built community. This is my first visit to Jacob Burns. I can't believe it. This is like incredible, incredible. I mean, you're giving young people the power, you're giving them voice to express themselves in the greatest medium we have on the planet now. The greatest, you know, way to communicate with each other globally. And I haven't seen a facility anywhere, you know, in any university that comes close to what's happening here, and it's all based on generosity. It's all based on helping people, on giving, on honoring the volunteers, not the big shots. And I'm, the mycelial network brought us together. The mycelial network has kind of, you know, brought all of you guys together, and I'm just incredibly grateful to all of you. Thank you.
Thanks so much for coming.